The Achaemenid Empire lasted 208 years. The Macedonian Empire of Alexander the Great lasted 231. The Roman Republic lasted 233. Romanov Russia lasted 234. Today, the United States of America is 244 years old. What happens next? Where do we go from here? What do we build out of the ashes? Hello, I'm Kenaz Filan, and these are notes from the end of time.
Hello again, everybody. Kenaz Filan here with you for the 11th episode of Notes from the End of Time. Last week, we talked about C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity, and as promised, this week we're going to focus on C.S. Lewis's views on Christian morality. This is actually a very fortuitous event because my friend Tom Kaczynski is releasing his new book, In God We Must. I did some edits on it. I have read through it. It's an excellent book, and he talks a great deal about the value of Christian morality for keeping together a coherent and just society, and so it's a good tie-in. I definitely recommend you pick this book up as soon as you get the chance. It's going to be available on Amazon for as long as Amazon keeps it there. But let's start by examining the differences between a Christian's morality and the secular morality that's most common in our contemporary Western society. The French Revolution dethroned God and put man at the center of the universe, mankind in the aggregate, the brotherhood of man, the fraternity of man, as you will. And I think we can see that humanity is a pretty impressive species. We have done a lot on this planet. Certainly our history is pretty impressive. But is humanity perfect? No. In fact, if you look over the aggregate at human history, you would argue that not only are human beings not perfect, we could be a pretty nasty species. We have an unbroken record of atrocities reaching back from prehistory. We have an unbroken record of behavior that we look at today that we could have looked at 2,000 years ago and said was cruel and unjust. But how do you set human beings at the center of the universe when they're small, flawed beings? And today, postmodern humanism has gone one step beyond that. They've gone from privileging the brotherhood of man and the fraternity of man and reason to privileging the individual and individual identity. Once man was going to be the great God of the universe, today everybody is their own God. The idea is everybody should have as much personal autonomy as possible to live their lives however they see fit, and that we, society's main goal, society's main purpose, is to provide the space for where every individual can reach his, her, their pronoun of choices, highest of life, and become the best individual that individual can become. And if it's silly to take the human race as the center of the universe, and if it's silly to take the white race or the black race or any other race as the center of the universe, what kind of insanity is it to say that an individual is God? You know, to say that the individual's needs and wants and the individual should be the center pole around which all of society operates. And Christianity's view of the individual and of the individual's role is radically different. For one thing, most modern people start with the idea that the universe expanded out of nothing and is the product of materialistic forces. It came ab nihilo, and with the heat death of the universe, it will end ex nihilo. The Christian view holds that the universe was created by God and that everything we see in this world, everything we experience in this world, our bodies, our thoughts, were all created in the beginning by God, and that God had a purpose for this creation. As C.S. Lewis puts it, Christianity is a fighting religion. It thinks God made the world, that space and time, heat and cold, and all the colors and tastes, and all the animals and vegetables are things that God made up out of his head as a man makes up a story. But it also thinks that a great many things have gone wrong with the world that God made, and that God insists, and insists very loudly, on our putting them right again. And, of course, that raises a very big question. If a good God made the world, why has it gone wrong? And for many years, I simply refused to listen to the Christian answers to this question, because I kept on feeling, whatever you say and however clever your arguments are, isn't it much simpler and easier to say that the world was not made by any intelligent power? Aren't all your arguments simply a complicated attempt to avoid the obvious? But then that threw me back into another difficulty. My argument against God was that the universe seemed so cruel and unjust. But how had I got this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? If the whole show was bad and senseless from A to Z, so to speak, why did I, who was supposed to be a part of the show, find myself in such violent reaction against it? A man feels wet when he falls into water because man is not a water animal. A fish would not feel wet. Of course, I could have given up my idea of justice by saying it was nothing but a private idea of my own. But if I did that, then my argument against God collapsed too, for the argument depended on saying that the world was really unjust, not simply that it did not happen to please my private fancies. Thus, in the very act of trying to prove that God did not exist, in other words, that the whole of reality was senseless, I found I was forced to assume that one part of reality, namely my idea of justice, was full of sense. Consequently, atheism turns out to be too simple. If the whole universe has no meaning, we should never have found out that it has no meaning. Just as, if there were no light in the universe, and therefore no creatures with eyes, we should never know it was dark. Dark would be without meaning. And so Christianity starts with the premise that the universe and our sense of morality were created by a good God who expects us to follow that morality and who expects us to take part in the active part in the making things better in this flawed and broken world. And toward that end, Christians have come up with systems of Christian morality. And this is a favorite topic of comedians all across America. Dana Carvey and the Church Lady, everybody remembers that. Oh, isn't that special? And blaming Satan for everything. There's Betty Bowers, America's Best Christian, is a famous web personality. Everybody likes to poke fun at Christian hypocrisy and priggishness. We're anti-sex, anti-pleasure. But it's a lot more complicated than that. As C.S. Lewis says, moral rules are directions for running the human machine. Every moral rule is there to prevent a breakdown or a strain or a friction in the running of that machine. And that's something really important. The Christian conception of God is the creator of the universe. Our sins don't harm God, they harm other people, and most of all, they harm the sinner. There was a recent controversy where Pope Francis supposedly said that, you know, the pleasures of sex and the table were divine, and that what he had actually said, the Pope gets misquoted a lot, by the way, was that pleasure was not inherently sinful. And that's a completely Christian conception. God gave us food that tastes good because we should enjoy the taste of good food. God made sex feel good because we should have sex and propagate the species. It's good for us. We are not anti-pleasure, but we believe that pleasure has to be enjoyed in moderation, and too much of a good thing becomes a bad thing. And this is not an exclusively Christian idea. Marcus Aurelius would have told you as much. Aristotle would have told you as much with the golden mean. It's, you know, I'd argue it's common sense, but as we all know, it's kind of, sense is kind of uncommon nowadays. It's not about being anti-pleasure. It's about avoiding activities and avoiding situations which are harmful or corrosive to the individual or to the society. Lewis points out there are two ways in which the human machine goes wrong. One is when human individuals drift apart from one another, or else collide with one another and do another damage by cheating or bullying. The other is when things go wrong inside the individual, when the different parts of him, his different faculties and desires and so on, either drift apart or interfere with one another. You can get the idea plain if you think of us as a fleet of ships sailing in formation. The voyage will be a success only, in the first place, if the ships do not collide and get in one another's way, and secondly, if each ship is seaworthy and has her engines in good order. As a matter of fact, you cannot have either of these two things without the other. But he adds a third thing. The fleet also has to know where it's going. If the fleet's sailing in formation, where is it headed to? You know, what's the general purpose of human life? We could talk about the individual being in tune with himself. We could talk about the individual being in tune with society. What are the goals of that society? What's the purpose we're here for? And today we're encouraged to find our own bliss, to create ourselves. There's no idea that there's any set purpose we should do. The idea we have some kind of divine obligations, or really much in the way of social obligations, is really deprecated. It's really treated as like a silly, superstitious idea. But we can see the consequence of that. What we have is a very, very atomized society full of individuals who don't really share much with each other except each trying to desperately get attention on their OnlyFans accounts or through like whatever outrageous behavior, declaring themselves whatever gender or mental illness or what have you is fashionable this week. It's, you don't really see a quest towards doing good in the world. You see much more a quest towards gaining attention. Our ideal is all these individuals competing against each other in the dog-eat-dog world and survival of the fittest and all of that will lead to the best rising to the top. This is the whole theory of capitalism. And I think the best answer to the dog-eat-dog world is that, first of all, we are human beings. We're not dogs. And secondly, dogs know more about loyalty and sacrificing even their lives for a loved one than the Lalbertarians who are beating their chest about that dog-eat-dog world. And I think most listeners can agree that not only is a dog-eat-dog world an ugly place, it's not a place where the best rise to the top. Certainly, I think you may have noticed that a lot of the people that are leading us are not our best and our brightest, and they certainly are not our most moral. Most of us can understand we'd like a place that's better than that. And again, Tom's new book goes into a lot of detail about this, and he came to the same conclusion that C.S. Lewis did, great minds thinking alike and all that. The only way you reform a society, the only way you can have a moral society, is if it's made up of moral individuals. And today, the main guidance individuals in America and in Western society get is do whatever you want so long as nobody gets hurt. And let's be fair, that's not moral guidance. That's a harried mother sending the kids out in the yard to play while she has a glass of wine and pops a Xanax. Lewis starts with a list of virtues that a good individual should practice, and he starts out with four classics. They're called the cardinal virtues. They're the pivotal virtues. It doesn't mean cardinals in the Roman Church. It means like the four cardinal points of a compass. Prudence, temperance, justice, and fortitude. This comes from Thomas Aquinas. It also comes from Aristotle. These are very ancient virtues. These virtues have been upheld in pretty much every society has come up with some version of these. The first one is prudence, and Lewis describes that as practical common sense, taking the trouble to think out what you're doing and what's likely to come of it. It's basic forethought, you know, weighing your actions against a moral code, making the conscious choice to do what is right and to prune out of your life the things that are bad or the things that lead you into wrongdoing. You know, for example, if you're an alcoholic and I am a recovering alcoholic, prudence tells me I shouldn't have that one drink because it will lead to 20. For other people who don't have the condition which leads me to alcoholism, temperance would tell them to have that one drink and stop there rather than having a second and a third. And thanks to the American Temperance Movement and the Women's Christian Temperance Union, temperance is frequently associated with prohibition, with teetotaling, with the classic image of the dour, scowling, no-fun Christians, when in fact, temperance really just means take your pleasure in moderation. And you'll notice in the modern world, moderation has almost become a dirty word. You either get to celebrate something 100% all the time. You know, if you don't let me wear my leather outfit and my vibrating butt plug in the office, you're interfering with my rights as a lifestyle submissive. Or something is absolutely bad and must be banned whenever and wherever possible. The modern things that are intolerable are intolerance and repression. If you're repressing somebody, that's awful. We can't have repression. We have to be free to live exactly as we want to be, and everybody has to accept it or we're being repressed. You have to cheer for everything, whether or not you believe in it or you're intolerant. And I think a lot of this stems from the fact that one of the big hallmarks of modern postmodern, if you will, ideology is that the human being starts life as a tabula rasa, as a blank slate who is entirely shaped by social factors and by environmental factors. People go on at length about Calvin's ideas of predestination, but what they don't realize is the tabula rasa idea is every bit as revolves around predestination every bit as much as any of Calvin's ideas. I mean, at least Calvin said a few people were chosen to be elect, but in the ideal world of postmodernism, everybody is simply whatever they were shaped to be by their social and environmental factors. And so if we're going to make a better person, we have to get rid of all those harmful stimuli. There's no idea there that human beings have an innate knowledge of the moral law and are capable of choosing between right and wrong, and no efforts to really educate people as to how to use that moral sense. It's simply, we must get rid of anything which stands in our way. Don't get me wrong, Christian theories of government certainly hold that we should not encourage vice and that there are activities which should be sanctioned and illegal. But there's also the idea that the individual plays a role in his or her own salvation, that the individual is capable of making choices and that the individual can choose to use things in moderation, to do things in moderation, and the individual contains within himself or herself the capacity for reflection, for regret, and for changing their lives. In medieval Europe, brothels were not banned, but the church took great efforts to create homes for reformed prostitutes, to offer a way out of that life for women who sought it. Monks brewed beer, but at the same time they condemned drunkenness when it led to people forsaking their duties to themselves and to the community and to God. The leftist approach seems to be suppress anything that we find sinful, though of course they would object to the use of the word sin, by stomping it out with force. And okay, you got a Catholic speaking here. Speaking from our experience, stamping things out by force, more often than not, has the exact opposite effect of what you're trying to do. And Lewis makes another important point about temperance, and this is another one that gets missed a lot. We tend to think of temperance in terms of alcohol, in terms of drugs, in terms of addiction, but you are supposed to, as a Christian, and I think it's good advice as a human being, to show temperance in all of your pleasures. For example, you can be a shopping addict. You can, if anything you do which takes time away from your family, from your social obligations, from your duties to God, can become a bad thing. And again, the golden mean of Aristotle, like Aurelius, again, the Stoics talked about this. You should strive to achieve moderation in everything in life. That can mean learning to be satisfied when you have enough rather than having more than enough or having to go from being wealthy to obscenely wealthy. I think we see many people in American society today who are intemperate about their wealth, who have taken the pursuit of wealth, which again, that in and of itself's not a bad thing. But they've turned that into their religion in place of anything else. They've placed being successful, being famous, getting to, when your life revolves around how many clicks you can get, how many likes on OnlyFans, how much you're like, wow, I'm now an influencer on social media. That can become a cause of intemperance. And Lewis also talks about justice, and what he calls it is our innate sense of fairness, of fair play, the idea we should keep our promises, the idea that we should obey laws insofar as they are just laws. Those ideas, again, that's part of the moral law, which is ingrained into ourselves, into, as a Christian, I'd say, into our souls. And I think there's a near universal recognition at this point that our society and that the government we live under is fundamentally unjust. I believe that there are outside actors funding the BLM rioters and that have been funding the protests, but I also think that those protests are rooted in a deep sense of rage at the unjustness and the inequities within American society. I believe that sense of justice and fairness has been weaponized against us by people who do not have our best interests at heart, nor do I believe they have the best interests of the people protesting in the street at heart. But I think it just goes to show, again, how strongly that sense of justice is ingrained within us and how strongly we react instinctively on a gut level when we perceive injustice. And of course, all of these ideals, temperance can be a difficult thing to accomplish. You're always tempted to have one more donut, or to spend one more hour on social media instead of talking to your family. I gotta admit, I've been guilty of that one on many occasions. But it's hard to be just when you've got a very powerful, unjust government that's seeking to silence you. It's hard to be prudent when you just want to do something impulsively and immediately. And a lot of times, practicing these virtues can get you in a great deal of trouble. They can be a hassle. And so we need the fourth cardinal virtue, which is fortitude. The word that Lewis said would probably be the best synonym in the vernacular English of the mid-20th century, it's still one that works now, is guts. You know, you gotta have the intestinal fortitude to go through with something even though it's difficult and even if it's dangerous. That's one of the real important ones, because without fortitude, those other three virtues are pretty much useless. I mean, it's great, you see justice, but if you're not strong enough to work toward justice, then Lewis distinguishes between a just action and a just man. A person can on occasion be temperate. A person can on occasion be just. There's no human being is all evil. There's nobody who doesn't do the right thing on occasion. But the idea is, just like being a tennis player, the more you practice these virtues, the more you reflect on these virtues, and the more you strive to live up to them, the more you become inclined to do virtuous actions. That's how you become a more virtuous person. Again, nobody expects that you're always going to do the right thing. In fact, as Christians, human corruption is a core part of our religion. We know human beings are flawed. If we weren't flawed, the whole mystery of the resurrection would have been unnecessary. But there's an important corollary to that. Just as we become more inclined toward virtue by practicing virtuous actions, so does continued practice of vice lead us to more inclination to vice. And from here we get into what is today probably the most controversial part of Christian morality, sexual morality, or as Christians like to call it, chastity. As Lewis puts it, chastity is the most unpopular of the Christian virtues. There's no getting away from it. The old Christian rule is either marriage with complete faithfulness to your partner, or else total abstinence. Now, this is so difficult and so contrary to our instincts, as Lewis says, that obviously either Christianity is wrong or our sexual instinct, as it now is, has gone wrong, one or the other. Of course, being a Christian, I think it is the instinct which has gone wrong. But I have other reasons for thinking so. The biological purpose of sex is children, just as the biological purpose of eating is to repair the body. Now, if we eat whenever we feel inclined and just as much as we want, it's quite true that most of us will eat too much, but not terrifically too much. One man may eat enough for two, but he does not eat enough for 10. The appetite goes a little beyond its biological purpose, but not enormously. But if a healthy young man indulged his sexual appetite whenever he felt inclined, and if each act produced a baby, then in 10 years he might easily populate a small village. This appetite is ludicrous and preposterous excess of its function. Or take it another way. You can get a large audience together for a striptease act. That is, to watch a girl undress on the stage. Now, suppose you came to a country where you could fill a theater by simply bringing a covered plate onto the stage and then slowly lifting the cover so as to let everyone see, just before the lights went out, that it contained a mutton chop or a bit of bacon. Would you not think that in that country something had gone wrong with the appetite for food? And would not anyone who had grown up in a different world think there was something equally queer about the state of the sex instinct among us? They tell you sex has become a mess because it was hushed up. But for the last 20 years, it has not been hushed up. It has been chattered about all day long. Yet it is still in a mess. If hushing up had been the cause of the trouble, ventilation would have set it right. But it is not. I think it is the other way around. I think the human race originally hushed it up because it had become such a mess. Modern people are always saying sex is nothing to be ashamed of. They may mean two things. They may mean there is nothing to be ashamed of in the fact that the human race reproduces itself in a certain way, nor in the fact that it gives pleasure. If they mean that, they are right. Christianity says the same. It is not the thing nor the pleasure that is the trouble. The old Christian teacher said that if man had never fallen, sexual pleasure, instead of being less than it is now, would actually have been greater. Our warped natures, the devils who tempt us, and the contemporary propaganda for lust combine to make us feel that the desires we are resisting are so natural, so healthy, and so reasonable that it is almost perverse and abnormal to resist them. Poster after poster, film after film, novel after novel associate the idea of sexual indulgence with the ideas of health, normality, youth, frankness, and good humor. Now this association is a lie. Like all powerful lies, it is based on a truth. The truth acknowledged above, that sex in itself, apart from the excesses and obsessions that have grown round it, is normal and healthy, and all the rest of it. The lie consists in the suggestion that any sexual act to which you are tempted at the moment is also healthy and normal. Now this, on any conceivable view, and quite apart from Christianity, must be nonsense. Surrender to all our desires obviously leads to impotence, disease, jealousies, lies, concealment, and everything that is the reverse of health, good humor, and frankness. For any happiness, even in this world, quite a lot of restraint is going to be necessary. Mere Christianity was released in 1952. It was based on lectures that Lewis had given 10 years earlier during the war. Today we're nearly 80 years on from when he made those 1943 speeches, and I think it's pretty clear things have gotten worse. I mean, he was worried about movies and pulp novels. Today we've got Pornhub and MindGeek that'll stream in any type of perversion I could possibly imagine, and quite a few I would rather not imagine, at the click of a mouse. And we're talking more frankly about sex today than we ever did. We're teaching middle schoolers how to use condoms. Teen Vogue was teaching its readers, young readers, about anal sex and threesomes. We're 50 years into the sexual revolution, and yet all of the bad things that C.S. Lewis prophesied came true. We have a whole generation of young men who have, like Pavlov's dog, sexualized themselves to images on a screen. They're like those people Lewis talked about in that foreign country slavering over food. They spend hours of their day sitting there masturbating to pictures of naked women, naked whatever. They have little or no interest in having a relationship with a woman, and when they try, many of them find themselves impotent because, of course, reality can't match up to the idealized images that they've been pumping in through that screen. It's really telling to me that when we saw the beginning of a grassroots anti-porn movement, the NoFap movement, it was immediately castigated in Rolling Stone and a few other publications as anti-Semitic and alt-right, and it was seen as a sure ticket to white supremacism. How is saying "don't masturbate to porn" anti-Semitic? Is there some comment in the Talmud that says we should masturbate to porn? Am I missing something here? How is it alt-right to tell people, tell young boys, many of whom are quite literally addicted to porn, there's a dopamine rush associated with masturbation, just like there's a dopamine rush associated with smoking crack? It's not even a financial threat. Trust me, again, speaking from experience, teenage boys will find things to masturbate to. It's not like NoFap was suddenly cutting into the revenues of Pornhub and MindGeek and all of the other websites which have sprung up to provide us with any kind of sexual stimulation we want when we want it. There's no real threat here to the industry, but yet for some reason, the idea that there might be a teenage boy somewhere who's not touching himself while watching pornography was treated as some kind of an existential threat. And of course, the common answer, as given by psychologists who are handsomely paid by the porn industry, would be that this is leading to sexual repression, which is a bad thing. But Lewis points out, people misunderstand what psychology teaches about repressions. It teaches us that repressed sex is dangerous, but repressed is here a technical term. It does not mean suppressed in the sense of denied or resisted. A repressed desire or thought is one which has been thrust into the subconscious, usually at a very early age, and can now come before the mind only in a disguised and unrecognizable form. Repressed sexuality does not appear to the patient to be sexuality at all. When an adolescent or an adult is engaged in resisting a conscious desire, he is not dealing with a repression, nor is he in the least danger of creating a repression. On the contrary, those who are seriously attempting chastity are more conscious and soon know a great deal more about their own sexuality than anyone else. They come to know their desires as Wellington knew Napoleon, or as Sherlock Holmes knew Moriarty, as a rat catcher knows rats, or a plumber knows about leaky pipes. Virtue, even attempted virtue, brings light. Indulgence brings fog. And while it gets most of the attention, and it got most of the attention in C.S. Lewis's day, Lewis said, I want to make it as clear as I possibly can that the center of Christian morality is not here. If anyone thinks that Christians regard unchastity as the supreme vice, he is quite wrong. The sins of the flesh are bad, but they are the least bad of all sins. All the worst pleasures are purely spiritual. Pleasures of putting other people in the wrong, of bossing and patronizing and spoiling sport and backbiting, the pleasures of power, of hatred. For there are two things inside me competing with the human self which I must try to become. They are the animal self and the diabolical self. The diabolical self is the worse of the two. That is why a cold, self-righteous prig who goes regularly to church may be far nearer to hell than a prostitute. But of course, it's better to be neither. In fact, his defense of Christian marriage is less about fornication than about the promise which you make upon marriage to be together till death do us part, forsaking all others. When you fail to live up to that vow, when you seek partners outside of marriage, or when you choose to dissolve this marriage, you're breaking an oath, and that goes against justice. We're weakening the structures of the family, which is the building block of every society. You're also weakening your character. Lewis noted he was not a married man. I am a married man with a child, and I will attest to you, marriage can be difficult. There will be times that you're tempted to walk out of the marriage. There will be times that you're tempted to stray from the marriage. There are definitely abusive marriages, and there are definitely dysfunctional marriages. But to break a marriage, Lewis said, you know, some churches, the Catholic Church believes marriage is for life. We're pretty notorious about not accepting divorce. There's other churches that will accept it as an absolute last case. The analogy Lewis used was basically you should consider dissolving a marriage to be as serious a thing as amputating a leg. You do everything you can to keep the leg until it becomes absolutely positively clear this is gangrenous and it's not working at all. With the advent of no-fault divorce, we've seen so many children growing up in single-parent homes. We've seen so many children growing up with abusive step-parents. We've seen all kinds of issues here. And I agree that some marriages are toxic and the partners need to be away from each other, but That should be the rare exception, not the general rule. And I think a lot of marriages today are dissolved not because they were dysfunctional, but because the partners, expecting constant stimulation and entertainment and great sex, like they had been led to believe was their birthright, decided to leave the marriage when it suddenly became difficult and stopped being exciting and interesting. We have a world where casual sex is easy to find, but committed relationships are almost impossible, and we are not happier for it. Lewis goes on to talk about a Christian virtue which may be even more unpopular than chastity, and that's forgiveness. What does it mean to love your neighbor as yourself? This one sounds really challenging, but Lewis gives it a little thought, and there are times when I don't like myself very much. There's times when I've done things I'm ashamed of. You know, to be quite honest, I've done quite a few things in my life where I deserved a good ass kicking, and I could think of many times where my life would have been approved by somebody giving me a short, sharp shock upside the head and letting me know what I was doing was completely out of line. But forgiveness means understanding that my enemy and I share human flaws. We are both capable of doing both evil and good. It involves treating your enemy, treating the other like a human being. And it may involve overlooking an insult or an offense rather than seeking an eye for an eye. But it always involves recognizing your enemy as a fellow human and understanding that you, like your enemy, possess the capacity for evil and that your enemy, like you, possesses the capacity for good. Lewis put it this way. The real test is this. Suppose one reads a story of filthy atrocities in the paper. Then suppose that something turns up suggesting the story may not be quite true or not quite so bad as it was made out. Is one's first feeling, thank God, even they aren't quite so bad as that? Or is it a feeling of disappointment and even a determination to cling to the first story for the sheer pleasure of thinking your enemies as bad as possible? If it is the second, then it is, I am afraid, the first step in a process which, if followed to the end, will make us into devils. You see, one is beginning to wish that black was a little blacker. If we give that wish its head, later on we shall wish to see gray as black, and then to see white itself as black. Finally, we shall insist on seeing everything, God and our friends and ourselves included, as bad and not be able to stop doing it. We shall be fixed forever in a universe of pure hatred. I imagine somebody will say, well, if one is allowed to condemn the enemy's acts and punish him and kill him, what difference is left between Christian morality and the ordinary view? All the difference in the world. Remember, we Christians think man lives forever. Therefore, what really matters is those little marks or twists on the central inside part of the soul, which are going to turn it, in the long run, into a heavenly or a hellish creature. We may kill if necessary, but we must not hate and enjoy hating. We may punish if necessary, but we must not enjoy it. In other words, something inside us, the feeling of resentment, the feeling that wants to get one's own back, must be simply killed. I do not mean that anyone could decide this moment that he will never feel it anymore. That is not how things happen. I mean that every time it bobs its head up, day after day, year after year, all our lives long, we must hit it on the head. It is hard work, but the attempt is not impossible. Even while we kill and punish, we must try to feel about the enemy as we feel about ourselves, to wish that he were not bad, to hope that he may, in this world or another, be good. In fact, to wish his good. And as things are continuing to heat up and war looks like it's coming closer every day, I think this one's just going to be so important for all of us to keep in mind. And I urge you, if you're listening, you don't have to be a Christian. Just please keep these words under consideration. Let's try to view each other as fellow human beings. Let's try to treat each other as we would be treated. To explain the first of the three great Christian virtues, humility, Lewis focuses on the first sin and what he considers to be truly the deadliest of all of the sins, and that's pride. As he puts it, according to Christian teachers, the essential vice, the utmost evil, is pride. Unchastity, anger, greed, drunkenness, and all that are mere flea bites in comparison. It was through pride that the devil became the devil. Pride leads to every other vice. It is the complete anti-God state of mind. Does this seem to you exaggerated? If so, think it over. I pointed out a moment ago the more pride one had, the more one disliked pride in others. In fact, if you want to find out how proud you are, the easiest way is to ask yourself, how much do I dislike it when other people snub me or refuse to take any notice of me or shove their oar in or patronize me or show off? The point is that each person's pride is in competition with everyone else's pride. It's because I wanted to be the big noise at the party that I'm so annoyed at someone else being the big noise. Two of a trade never agree. Now, what you want to get clear is that pride is essentially competitive. It's competitive by its very nature, while the other vices are competitive only, so to speak, by accident. Pride gets no pleasure out of having something, only out of having more of it than the next man. We say people are proud of being rich or clever or good-looking, but they are not. They are proud of being richer or cleverer or better-looking than others. If everyone else became equally rich or clever or good-looking, there'd be nothing to be proud about. It is the comparison that makes you proud, the pleasure of being above the rest. Once the element of competition is gone, pride has gone. That's why I say pride is essentially competitive in a way the other vices are not. The sexual impulse may drive two men into competition if they both want the same girl, but that is only by accident. They might just as likely have wanted two different girls. But a proud man will take your girl from you, not because he wants her, but just to prove to himself that he's a better man than you. Greed may drive men into competition if there's not enough to go round, but the proud man, even when he's got more than he could possibly want, will try to get still more just to assert his power. Nearly all those evils in the world which people put down to greed or selfishness are really far more the result of pride. Other vices may sometimes bring people together. You may find good fellowship and jokes and friendliness among drunken people or unchaste people, but pride always means enmity. It is enmity. And not only enmity between man and man, but enmity to God. In God, you come up against something which is in every respect immeasurably superior to yourself. Unless you know God as that, and therefore know yourself as nothing in comparison, you do not know God at all. As long as you are proud, you cannot know God. A proud man is always looking down on things and people. And of course, so long as you are looking down, you cannot see something that is above you. Lewis makes a couple of important distinctions. First, he distinguishes between pride and pleasure in being praised. It's all right to get a warm glow when you've pleased somebody with your performance. It's okay to feel good about getting a performance award at work. It's okay to feel good about your father or your teacher praising you for a test. The problem comes in when you start taking that praise as a, like, wow, I must be a really superb and a wonderful person. I must be better than all those other people who didn't accomplish what I accomplished. Lewis also distinguishes between pride and vanity. I mean, we all know somebody who's like some woman who's really vain about her hair or some, you know, I tend to be at times vain about my IQ. I have to admit that. I've at times even gone so far as to look down on other people. That's something I need to work on. But vanity involves a human competence. The vain person deep down is insecure and needs affirmation from others. It's a vice, but it's still a human vice. It's still rooted in concern for what your fellows think of you. It's not the pride that sets you apart from everybody else, the pride that leaves you looking down on the world, thinking of them all as rabble and yourself as some kind of special and enlightened being. Pride doesn't care about what other people think. It only cares that it's better than those other people. He also mentions like a warm sense of familial affection, what we often call pride, like, you know, I'm proud of my family, I'm proud of my daughter, I'm proud, you know, I'm proud of your being a European American and a member of West, you know, part of the group of people that created Western civilization. There's nothing wrong with me having a warm affection for my fellow working class white people and feeling a sense of kinship and affinity for them. This will become a big problem when I start thinking, you know, well, I'm white and that makes me better than that nigger. You know, well, I'm a Christian and that makes me better than that goat-humping Muslim or that Christ-killing Jew. Those are not helpful. Those, when you go on that route, you've hit the sin of pride, and it will only serve to set you apart, to alienate you, and to lead you further away from God. You can even see this in the white pride movements that you see on the alt-right. Look how often it turns into, we're the based people, we're the white power, we're better, you know, we're not just better than all those mud people, we're better than those white cucks, we're better than those shit libs. And the fact that I feel an affinity for working class white people or for Western civilization should not, and it really does not mean that I look down on any other civilization or any other people. There are serious theological differences between Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. I can acknowledge those differences without thinking that everybody who does not believe as I do is somehow less than a human being, or that my adherence to those principles makes me in any way better than them. It may make me saved, depending on whether or not you believe Christianity, but it does not make me better. We are still both human beings made in the image of God. And I think it's telling that the rallying cry of the LGBT movement, the rallying cry of so many of these identity groups that have sprung up like crabgrass is pride. What you wind up with is these generally broken children and young people who start piling on all sorts of identities based on sexual preferences, on their gender identity, on their diagnosed or self-diagnosed mental illnesses, and bringing this all together in some desperate effort to prove to the world that they're really some very special person and they're not like all those other boring, normal, cishet people. And I will acknowledge that a lot of this looks more like what Lewis called vanity. It's this desperate need for acceptance. But in framing it as pride, they've shut off the ability for this individual to actually interrogate that lifestyle, you know, interrogate those labels they've chosen for themselves and decide if they're workable or even if they're moral. Because, of course, you're supposed to be proud of them. And if you're not proud, it's just part of that ugly old repression coming back in. It's that evil Christian conditioning that makes you want to, that expects you to be humiliated all the time. When, in fact, humility simply means knowing your place in the world. And if you're a Christian, you realize you are infinitesimally small next to infinity, recognizing that the gifts which you have, and it's perfectly acceptable to acknowledge your gifts. You know, I will acknowledge I was born with a higher than average IQ, but I was given that gift by God with the intention that I would use it to make the world a better place. And when you start looking at things that way, rather than, wow, aren't I a wonderful, spectacular person? It's just like, you know, God gave me this gift. What should I do with it? You know, how can I make the world a better place for the people who don't have that gift? You start dealing with people on a very different level. Humility gives you more options to question your own behavior, to make honest amends when you've done wrong. It's a much healthier and saner way of dealing with the world than going around with your chest puffed out, thinking that you're special because of whatever cause you've chosen to represent yourself, whatever pole or poles you've chosen to hang your identity on. And learning humility is an ongoing process. I'll admit, I stumble on the sin of pride. It's a big sin, and it's a difficult one to get overcome, but it's worth overcoming, and it's certainly worth questioning why we've made pride such a focus of our society when, through most of Western civilization, it was seen as the greatest vice. And while loving one's neighbor could be hard, Lewis gives us some honest advice on that. You don't have to love people, but so long as you treat them as if you love them, in time you just may find those emotions stirring in your heart. As he puts it, do not waste time bothering whether you love your neighbor. Act as if you did. As soon as we do this, we find one of the great secrets. When you are behaving as if you loved someone, you will presently come to love him. If you injure someone you dislike, you will find yourself disliking him more. If you do him a good turn, you will find yourself disliking him less. And that's something that Lewis states throughout Mere Christianity. You gain in the virtues by exercising the virtues. You gain especially when you are exercising those virtues against your instincts and even against your interests. And then Lewis goes on to another Christian virtue, hope. And he has such a beautiful explanation of this. The way he describes it is, everyone has a longing in their heart for something that cannot be had in this world. There's a Portuguese word, chidade, which is kind of translated loosely, would be, you know, a desire for a past that never was. It's, you know, that whole idea of an ideal we can never attain. We have that in our hearts. And there are, you know, he describes three different ways of dealing with that. The first he calls the fool's way is we're always longing for something that's better than what we have. And, you know, the fool puts the blames on things themselves. He thinks, you know, can I have, maybe if I had a different woman, maybe if I had a more expensive holiday, maybe if I had a bigger house, a better job, whatever, maybe then I'd catch that something that I feel that longing for in my heart. And because the fool is focusing on things of this world, on temporal pleasures, which by definition are going to be flawed and imperfect, he spends a lot of time being bored and discontented, you know, always searching for an answer, but never finding it. And we see, how much do we see that today? How we have a whole generation that's been taught that they should seek peak experiences. Well, sooner or later, you get tired of climbing peaks, and what you get is this enormous discontentment, the enemy that we see in our civilization. We also see what he calls the way of the disillusioned. You know, well, of course, everybody's got dreams. Everybody wants something better. But sooner or later, you got to give up chasing the rainbow's end and settles down. Don't expect too much. You know, don't cry for the moon. It may make you less miserable than the fool, but it doesn't really help you find that infinite happiness. You know, suppose that infinite happiness really is there waiting for us and we really can reach the rainbow's end, then the person who gave up on happiness is never going to reach it. Which brings us to what Lewis called the Christian way. And he points out, creatures are not born with desires unless satisfaction for those desires exist. A baby feels hunger. Well, there's such a thing as food. A duckling wants to swim. And well, there's such a thing as water. Men feel sexual desire. Well, there's such a thing as sex. If I find in myself a desire for which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. If none of my earthly pleasures satisfy it, that does not prove that the universe is a fraud. Probably earthly pleasures were never meant to satisfy it, but only to arouse it, to suggest the real thing. If that is so, I must take care, on the one hand, never to despise or be unthankful for these earthly blessings, and on the other, never to mistake them for the something else of which they are only a kind of copy or echo or mirage. I must keep alive in myself the desire for my true country, which I shall not find till after death. I must never let it get snowed under or turned aside. I must make it the main object of life to press on to that other country and to help others to do the same. And then we come to the last and the highest of the Christian virtues, which is faith, which is accepting the statements in the Bible, accepting Christianity as the true religion. And that's a big step. I've said before, the whole story behind Christianity is utterly absurd. It would have sounded silly in first century Rome. Most people think the story sounds silly today. I understand it's a tall hurdle to clear. But what I've found helps is when you explore the various alternatives, you find that sooner or later they're pinned on an absurdity that's even greater. As I've said, the chances of the universe rising out of mere mechanistic chance, it would be like winning a lottery where the odds were 10 billion to 1, winning it 10 billion times in a row. You still wouldn't be near where the odds you would need to have DNA arise up out of a pool of organic molecules. You're still not up to an explanation which explains why there is something in the universe instead of nothing. There are many great Christian apologists who have made what I feel to be a fantastic and a compelling, though admittedly not airtight argument. If it was an airtight argument, we wouldn't be talking about faith here because it was already proven. I definitely recommend picking up Mere Christianity and reading it. You can also find it online at archive.org. It's well worth a read. I think the case that Lewis makes for Christianity, like the case that Tolkien made for Christianity that convinced Lewis, I think they are compelling cases. And, you know, they were among the things that led to me choosing to throw my lot in with Christ. And if you have doubts about Christianity, it's all right to have doubts. You're allowed to question your faith. But as Lewis said, your faith can depend on your moods. There are times when it seems like God is nearby, and of course this whole thing makes perfect sense. There are times when it'll be like, this is crazy, why am I doing this? But what it is just like you should act as if you love your neighbor, even when you don't love your neighbor, I found that it helps to act as if you believe, even at times when you have doubts, and in time you'll find that you have less doubts and more ease in believing. I found that the world makes more sense when you throw a creator into the equation. A lot of things make much more sense. Certainly our political scene makes much more sense when you start talking about the reality of evil and about powers and principalities that rule this world. I can't promise you that accepting Christianity and accepting Christ will make your life better. It may cost you friends. It may cost you family. Historically, sometimes it's even cost you your life. But I can tell you that I believe it to be true. I can tell you that I stand under the shadow of the cross and I kneel before the one true King. And I invite anybody who does to join with me. I can't promise you will win. I can't even promise you will survive. But I can promise you in the name of God that if enough godly men get together and work to make the world a better place, we can change the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, thank you for listening. This has been the 11th issue of Notes from the End of Time. May God bless us, each and every one.